So hello and many thanks for being here. I want to present here my study on the orbital myocytes, and I think many of you know that we are since about 25 years busy with this group of fungi. The reason is that this group is much more diverse than originally thought. We have about 500 species presently, and it's also a very nice aesthetic group, and yes. And this study includes also a demonstration of the importance of vital taxonomy and what the consequences are in comparison to studying of herbarium material. Over a long time, we concentrated our work on the sexual morph. And a main characteristic of this class concerns the ascospores and their spore bodies. Both show a remarkable diversity in shape. And this spore body, this organelle, is of a vacuolar nature and is usually inserted in the spore apex, but may, as an exception, be laterally attached, for example, in this case, or here. You must know that this spore body is restricted to the living state. We see it very strongly in living spores. This is a dead ascus, but the spores are still alive. And when you stain it with crystal blue, you get selectively stained only the spore body. But in herbarium material, either in lethal mountains or when you keep it too long in the herbarium, then the spores are dead and you can hardly detect this structure. There are similar structures which are specific to Orbilium mycetes, but only in some of the species are these slightly orange bodies in the accipular cells, also in the paraphysis. And when you have that material, you can hardly recognize them. The color remains for some time, but the structure is lost. But they are very valuable at the species level, mainly. So our study revealed a high diversity in the external appearance, much higher than previously known. It includes a dark purple species, also black ones, and various kinds of hairs and teeth at the margin. And despite this diversity, many species, they look rather simple. For example, like this one, many species you cannot distinguish from external view. And frequently, different species grow together on a branch, sometimes 10 different species. And this complicates strongly, for example, molecular research when you want to gain a sequence and you get another species than you have studied under the microscope. What we also have in this group is a high diversity in conidial shape. These are mainly branched conidia what on this slide, and they almost exclusively occur on xeric substrate, on substrate that is exposed to dry air and usually dries out very soon after the rainfall. You know the term Ingoldian conidia, but they occur in the canopy of trees, and when it's raining, there is also an aquatic environment. And very interesting in this group is the predaceous capabilities. These Orbilium mycetes capture various types of animals, such as rhizopods or rotifers and nematodes and insects and mites and so on. Now, when molecular data on Orbilia became available, We know that this group clusters near the base of ascomycetes, and oops. You see here the emergence of ASCII, and here in the periphysis or the interascal filaments turned for the first time, and we have the orbiniomycetes here, quite close to the petitsomycetes. This association is often seen in trees. And previously, the family Orbiliaceae was placed in the Halocyales. The Halocyales are here, so they are clearly unrelated. Now, how to characterize the Orbiliomycetes by morphology? By the sexual morph, we have, interestingly, always inamyloid ASCII. I forgot to say that the amyloidity appears for the first time here in the petitsomycetes. We have some groups with amyloid ASCII, and in Orbilia we have no case of amyloidity, so one could think that amyloidity was invented at this blue point. However, I have an unpublished observation that in the Neolecta, in the genus Neolecta, hemiamyloid ASCII occur. So I cannot explain. Maybe it is polyphyletic, this character, or it got lost in the Orbiliomycetes at a very early time. So we have inamyloid ASCII. We have ascus apex, which is shouldered, biradial symmetrically, but only in the dead state. When it's living, you have turgescence, and this is strongly obscured, this character. We have the furcate ascus base, which lacks any crochias. Then very interesting is the inverted spore orientation, which you can see here. Often the lower spores are inverted. Then the ascospores have never a sheath around. The spore body is present in almost every species, but unknown in any other group of ascomycetes. Capitate periphyses are currently thought to be characteristic. Globose exibular cells are typical for many. And these cytoplasmic bodies, which I already mentioned. In the asexual morph, we have always a holoblastic conidiogenesis and never a yeast-like budding. And we have these trapping organs. I could include an ecological character, which is that these Orbiliomycetes are never found endophytically in plant tissue. So what groups of within Orbiliomycetes can we distinguish? We have here several genera at the base, which are comparatively small. Three of them, the red ones, are unpublished. And you see also the species number, which I indicated. These red ones are unpublished species. But we estimate that the species number, which we have presently about 500, is in fact much higher when more research would be done. I think 1,000 species would no problem to be finally detected. We apply a rather wide genus concept. So this genus Orbilia is really a big one, but we tended to keep this concept. And the genetic support of this tree, these branches below have a rather high support. You always find this grouping here with the genus Hyalobilia, comprising about 40 species. Vermispora is only known from the asexual state. with a few species only, and we have here some further small genera which are also always with high support. But this branching, the backbone of this branching of Orbilia is of low support, and the reason is probably that the ribosoma DNA is not suitable to get a good phylogeny. We have divided the genus Orbilia in various sections and subgenera, sections and series. And I must look. Yes, there are some groups which appear paraphyletic. For example, section Hemiorbilia is here and also here. And section Orangirubra is here and also here. Whether this is consistent, I do not believe, but it's often in any tree you find some groups which are not hanging together, but we have from the morphology a reason to keep them together. Now, when trying to apply a narrow concept, we always thought about, shall we do this or shall we keep the wide concept of Orbilia? When doing this, then we could, in a very narrow concept, distinguish here in the nematode-trapping fungi these four genera, and Dactylella is already a one which does not capture nematodes. This could be something like a subfamily, and the family Orbiliaceae could mean what was before Orbilia, and we would here distinguish different genera within the Orbiliaceae, but then we must consequently also here go a step higher and distinguish more families. Now, previous concepts of the Orbiliaceae were often based on single characters, such as hair types, periphysis shape, ascospore, or conidial shape. But all these features turned out to be of rather low significance, as you will see in the following. One is the glassy processes at the margin, which are composed of solid wall material, very similar as in the Hyolacyphaceae. And this character, which is very striking also by macroscopy, was used to define the genus Hyalinia. But on this slide you see that these glassy processes occur throughout most of the groups which we have. It's lacking here, but it's lacking here, otherwise it occurs and or not. It's sometimes between very closely related species you have it or you have it not, or you have your very short ones, and it's difficult to to draw a limit. Similarly, the septate hairs occur in as you see here in some groups, and it was used for defining the genus Orbiliaster. So what we can do is only to look for the type species and in which clade it falls, and maybe when using a narrow concept you can use the name Orbiliaster. I can say here that Orbiliaster is the same clade as Drexlerella, so and it is older, so we should then change to Orbiliaster when we follow the code. Paraphysis shape is not often capitate in the Orbiliaceae, but it's not a rare character, but many have uninflated paraphysis like this one. You see here the U stands for this uninflated paraphysis, and they are quite frequent. We have also spatulate ones, hooked sometimes, and this type with a rostrate or mummiform paraphysis was used as a character of the genus Hapuastictis, but the group in which this character is found here above, it's a very large group, has mainly it doesn't have this character, so it's an exception in this group. So we cannot use paraphysis shape for almost at any rank, only at the species. The same is true for the spore shape. Some workers have tried to group the Orbilias according to the shape, but we have very strong similarities. For example, these two ones, they can hardly be distinguished, but when you have the ascus apex, you see a strong difference, and when you take the genetics also, so the ascus apex is probably more important than the spore shape. Also such like auricular spores, like auricular occur, for example, here in a very different section of Orbilia, or even in the genus Hyalobilia, such curved spores occur. Polyspory is an interesting feature of the Orbiliaceae, and you see here in this listing that it occurs throughout the family. Already by morphology, you see that these species, this spore number is not useful at any rank except for the species, because these spores look very similar, and with this spore, not with the spore shape, but mainly with the spore body, you can classify groups. And so these species are rather unrelated, although they are polysporous. Polyspory is remarkably correlated with drought tolerance. Many species which are drought tolerant are also polysporous, and this is probably some kind of ecological adaptation. But also many drought tolerant species are eight-spored. It's not necessary to have many spores. But all which are intolerant against drying, they have always eight spores. Not clear why. And you see that the drought tolerant species, which I here termed xeric for the xeric substrate, they occur in many groups, but not all. Here they are rare, for example. Polyspores, small groups of species have sometimes or often in the number of spores. So here's an example of the Orbilia ionimi and its variants. Here the 16 spore variant, or the 64 spore and the 128 spore. And for the first time when I recognized these species, I was not sure if they belong to different species, but the genetics revealed that the difference in the ITS is between 6 and 15% between these species. So clearly we must distinguish them at the species level. But you see the spores are very similar, and this is an indication that they are closely related. What drought tolerant means, you see here, many mycologists do not know that fungi occur also on such dry branches. They usually look at the ground when they collect fungi. But Orbiliaceae are very frequently found on such dry branches, not only in the arid or semi-arid, or here's a semi-humid region, but also in the our temperate region. Many species occur only on such dry branches. And this is a landscape which is very suitable for Orbilias. I think some of you would not expect to find anything there, but it's really plenty of species and abundance of Apothecia can be found. the Abortezia survive in such a region up to 3 or 4 years in the herbarium. You can make cultures after 3 or 4 years. The Asteraceae are still alive. And when you consider that the precipitation is very rare in such region, you can imagine that Abortezia in the field, they survive, they exist there over many, many years. A single Abortezia, they must exist so long because the short rainfall does not allow to produce mature Abortezia. Now, which characters are useful for grouping? This is the Ascus apex, the Ascus base. The spore bodies I already mentioned, and a little bit the cytoplasmic bodies, the excipulum, and the trapping organs in the anamorph. So here the Ascus base. Not every Orbilia has this forked base, but at the base of the tree we have croesus. Either normal ones or such with a perforation, sometimes very large, but this is still a crozier. In this group, in Lecophagus, we have simple septate and croziers in very closely related species. So here it's variable, but from Orbilia onwards, we have always no croziers at all, or very exceptionally sometimes in some Asteraceae. So this is a very useful character. It's similar in the Petzizales. There we have also some groups which lack croziers and others which have. But in the Helochialis, we have often the case that within a genus it's variable. Ascus apex is one of the most important characters, in my opinion. The primitive one is hemispherical and thin-walled, which we have here. Hyalobilia is characterized always by such an ascus, and a modification of this, I consider the hemispherical ascus with a thick wall. And from this, maybe the evolution went to the thin-walled, truncate, shouldered ascus. In a few species, we have observed that they open by a slit. We assume that this is probably the case in all species. So we think that the rather basal grouping of the thick-walled hemispherical ascus indicates that this one and this one are the more the plesiomorphic character states. But in reality, it is a little bit more complicated because we have two further groups in which such thick-walled and hemispherical ascus types occur, but they are also partly truncate, and it's the limits are in these groups a little bit obscure. The question is whether the very similar ascus apex of Taphrina and Neolecta has to do with Orbilia or not. From the phylogeny, it's not easy because when I think that it is an apomorphy in Orbilia, then I cannot predict that or assert that it comes from Taphrina. I don't know. We cannot say for sure. But it's really similar. The spore body is probably originally globose and arranged at both spore ends, and the evolution may go to one spore end and to elongate, maybe become very narrow, or they occur lens-shaped spore body. Lens-shaped spore body, I once originally thought it might be the original type of spore body, but I'm not sure. It occurs at the base in here and here, and we have it also here. This slide, you see only that these STBs, they are absent from some groups like here or here, but otherwise they occur in mixed in both in one glade. Ah, yeah. It's one a slide which shows the characters of higher lobelia. It's interesting to know that the higher lobelias may also capture animals. They capture testaceous rhizopods mainly, but it's only known for a few species, or they parasitize in nematode eggs. And they are characterized by this symmetrical arrangement of the spore bodies, by usually uninflated periphyses, by crochets, and the thin-walled hemispherical apex might have evolved to the thick walls of Hemiorbilia. Now to the anamorphs. This slide shows the conidial shapes which we find in the drought intolerant habitats, in the hycric habitats, as I say. These conidia are mainly unbranched. Branching is quite rare. And they are sometimes only two-celled and such swollen. Rarely they form such protuberances, or they might be curled like a barrel. But only rarely they are curved like this one, or like this. But such the simple case of Dactylella-like conidia, it occurs in different groups. It's not a good character. And in the group of drought-tolerant species, we have this high diversity in branch types, but also such unbranched curved ones. They are almost always curved in this group. And you see also that the branching types, they are not very useful to characterize a group. The Dicranidion type, for example, occurs here, but it occurs also at the base here. I don't find it now, but it seems not be there. Or this one is a Dicranidion variant. The Trinacrium type of conidium occurs in different groups, also in higher lobelia. And the trapping organs are restricted, as far as we know, to a few groups. Here, the nematode trappers have every species has trapping organs. We have very rare case of Tridentaria here in this group, which contains the type species of Orbilia. This is observation by Drexler. And we have in Hyalobilia sometimes hints on trapping organs. And the genus Lecophagus is always with trapping organs. Whether the others are really non-predaceous, we can only assume, or we don't know. We can think about evolution of the trapping organs from the primitive ones over the adhesive knobs, forming rings. Mainly in this case is a tendency to form a ring, and the Arthropotris would be, Gamsilella made them from these ones, or Arthropotris here, and maybe the constricting rings are the uppermost evolutional type. However, the genetics for first here, you see that the trapping organs are here and here, and there is no connection between. We do not know where they come from. And in this case, we have Dactylella at the base without trapping organs. But here, and Drexlerella, the ones which might be the most evolved, are rather at the base of the nematode trapping fungi. But here is Drexlerella and Dactylella associated, and Arthropotris is at the base. So this is a multi-gain analysis. I'm not sure what we can believe. We cannot really say for sure which is the more primitive group of nematode-trapping fungi. So let me say at the end one word. The problem with monophily was addressed several times in this in our meeting, and I'm I think that paraphyletic groups play an important role, or they exist, they must exist in any phylogeny, because they are characteristic for the plesiomorphic characters. They must be paraphyletic. I have several examples in the oligomycetes where when you divide the groups according to monophyletic reasons, you get a strongly mixed morphology in these groups, and you cannot reasonably define them by morphology. And the question of predacity, if it is polyphyletic or not, we cannot know. And this slide shows that the importance of the vital taxonomy, because when we would not have studied Orbilias with in the vital state, I'm sure we would not distinguish not even half of the species. So thank you very much.